guys, it's good to be here. Let's give God praise today. We've got about 45 some odd guys. No, take that back. 45 and you're all odd. But it's good to be here. And I'm going to tell you something. You know it's true. You know, you really miss something when you don't have it. You learn to appreciate what we have because it might not always be this way. And so just this thing that we have come, we talked about it all the time, how we look forward to Friday and how the week is not the same if we miss Friday somehow. But I know that to be a fact in my life. And when the, you know, through the pandemic and through all of the stress across our nation and all we've seen, man, I got to tell you, I've longed to be in a room with my brothers. You know what I'm saying? Did you feel that ache as well? I was like, man, if we could, you know, I wanted to just talk to you. I just wanted to be in the room with you. I wanted us to make sure we cut through the noise and the nonsense that we're hearing, and let's get back to what we know, right? And let's be difference makers. We're going to show there is a difference that makes a difference. And so how I've looked forward to it, all right? So, guys, let's thank God for the food. Someone mentioned to me we need to begin to thank God. We didn't do that so much, I don't think, when we were here before. But let's thank God for even that biscuit, okay, and for the privilege we have of being together. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for our gathering together. Thank you for these men who've longed for this hour, who wouldn't have missed it for the world. Others who would be here, but for whatever reason, can't. For those who are vulnerable and won't be able to come to a meeting like this, we pray for them. We pray for those who are following online, or their people who are meeting together, following our meeting here together online. We pray for them. We thank you for the food that we've enjoyed today, and thank you for Tim and for his ministry to us. What a blessing it is. Thank you for that wonderful truth. Our God is still on the throne. God, that you can't be voted in or voted out. Lord, you're not affected by the polls. And Lord, help us as your people to rest in that. And to know, Father, that as has already been spoken to me this morning, that Romans 8:28 is in the book. All things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to your purpose. So we thank you. We pray that you be glorified in our time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, guys, you know that great verse, Romans 8:28, just quoted it, that all things, not just good things. Hey, buddy, good to see you, pal. All right, congratulations, all right, great victory. Not just the good thing, not just the sweet thing, not just the happy things, all things. I know we as Christians, and this should be the case, we know what we believe. What I'm not sure of, and I have to ask myself this as the Spirit of God searches me, not do I know what I believe, but rather do I really believe what I know? Do I really believe what I know? Because what I believe determines how I behave. So you can know things academically. You can know things. You can have your T's crossed and your I's dotted, and you can have knowledge, established knowledge that we call truth. We can have it packed down. We can know how to regurgitate it when needed, recite it. We know what we believe. But do we really believe what we know? Believe it to the extent that we are not disturbed and perturbed by what happens around us. We know that God is on the throne. Do we believe that? Do we believe it enough not to be anxious and have anxious fears and anxious cares about what we see going on in the culture? because that's the word for us. That's why God gives us these words. That's why God gives us this truth for us, not just to pack it down and to have it in this gray matter up here. He wants that thing to keep us. He wants that thing to guard us. He wants that thing to protect that peace. That's why he tells us whatever things are true and honest and pure and lovely and of good report and virtuous and worthy of praise to what? Think on these things. Right? That's why he tells us, let not your heart be troubled. That's why he tells us, be careful or anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. And watch this. And the peace of God that passes understanding will keep or garrison about, guard us. See, and then that's the difference that makes a difference. That's what God intends for us to be, difference makers, because the Word of God has made a difference in us. You got to be different to make a difference. So when the world is anxious and there is a sense of peace in your life because God is on the throne, because all things work together for good to them that love God, because he has kept me in perfect peace, because my mind is staying on him, Isaiah 26:3, all of these things, then there is that peace that comes, and that's different than those around us. I'm not talking about some contrived something that I'm, you know, grin and bear it and try to act the part. I'm talking about something that's genuine because I believe what I know. Like, I believe that. Right. So, guys, this is a rolling start, you know. We're getting going. And I'm thinking that sometime soon people will feel a little more comfortable in coming together and we'll be back and rolling. But this is a great, great start, all right? Thank you all for being here. I want to say this to you also. Now that we're back, you know, got the same Bible, here we all are together. I want to just say this to you because we come out of such a hype up political season, and we're not out of it. We're still in it. Things that are concerning and disconcerting and all of these things that are going on around us. I mean, you live in the world. We're not impervious to the news and trends and stuff like that. But I want to caution you. From time to time, I have, as a pastor, you might imagine this, that I you know, sometimes the curtain in people's homes are pulled back and the pastor just sees it. The good, the bad, and the what? The ugly. And sometimes the very ugly. Right? People you love the most can frustrate you the most. And that's why domestic flare-ups are more dangerous than anything else. The people you love the most can hurt you the most, frustrate you the most, and that. But you can imagine being a pastor for 34 years, you're going to be able to peak. And I don't care, family life brings its challenges. And you see things with couples, and you see things with parents and their children. What do you want me to do? You're pointing at something. What? Oh, that camera over there, that's my camera? Don't pay attention to you? Okay, all right. I was doing a great job of ignoring him till he started raising his hand. So what am I doing here? Okay. So what am I doing here? All right, let me talk to you all out here, all right? God, he's like, ignore him. Hey, don't pay any attention to me back here. So you might imagine that as a pastor, you get a chance to, you know, but that's where life is. That's where it's real. You know, we're not pretending. It's what it is, good, bad, and ugly. And so you see these problems. And so the pastor's brought into that, and you get in there and you try to minister, and that's good. One of the things I always say when dealing with a husband or a wife or family, I say, now listen, please allow me to preach like I always preached. Here's what I mean by that. Do not take that what I might say on the pulpit is me aiming at something that I know about your family. Don't begin to listen to me that way now. You know what I'm saying? Don't begin to listen to me like that's my situation and he's talking about me. He's talking about us. Don't get those kinds of ears, because all I want to do is preach the word of God like I've always preached the word of God. So don't be listening with these hyperactive ears and seeing anything that I say that I'm aiming at your family or exposing your family or that like that. Okay, can we get, so let me just say this. In this kind of a year in which we live, this time, hyper-politicized, everything is, you know, so tense and terse. And I felt it even in the church. It happens in the home. You know, lifelong relationships, lifelong friendships are fractured during political seasons. Brothers and sisters walk off and don't talk to each other anymore. You follow what I'm saying? Husbands and wives have rifts. Church, in church, you can feel it. You can sense it. So when you in a season like this, let me just tell you this. This is Kenny Grant, same Kenny Grant you've always known, or you think you've known, or, you know, do not come in here with these ramped up political ears and try to read into anything or everything I might say as being some political issue. Don't do that. That's not fair. Because here's what I know happens in this time. You can say eeny, meeny, miny, mo.
What do you mean by that?
You follow me? And the issue is not that I'm speaking in political speak. The issue is you listening with political ears. You follow what I'm saying? So, I said, maybe 5 weeks ago in church, listen, there's some people said that they came to church and people were not wearing masks, and so they didn't want to come back. I said, so, hey, listen, maybe you can be kind and wear a mask for your brother and sister when you come to church, and I wasn't going to be here mandating it and all of that, but I'm just saying you need to understand, you get in here, we social distance, we're doing all those things that we need to do, right? And even when we do that, that sounds political. You make a statement like that, that sounds political. Not because it's political, but because people are listening with such hyper-political ears. What is more Christian than, hey, yield the right of way, you've got brothers and sisters, and the Bible always say those who are weak and infirm, you bear the infirmities of the weak. Why is that a political statement? You know why? Because masks have been made political. Y'all get what I'm saying? I don't care if you don't. Y'all know who I am. I hope you do. But that's my point. See, we can listen with such, you know, that everything that is said. And so if I say wear a mask, that's political. If I say, hey, don't worry about a mask, that sounds political. The other day Sunday I was saying in church, I said, I'm a conservative person. I've always been a conservative. I believe in pro-life issues. Monday, two calls within 45 minutes of each other. One call was basically saying, I'm doing a song and dance for the conservatives. Didn't say conservatives, said white people. But now I'm just telling you, right? Within 45 minutes, another call, my statement was not strong enough. about pro-life issues. Oh, yeah, I got a Confederate top and a Union bottom. I'm getting shot at. I'm like, you know, from both sides. But look, I'm not up here boo-hooing. I'm just telling you that happens everywhere. And all I'm saying is let's be careful that when we get back, everything in my mind is not so heightened up that
the Band of Brothers changed, man. It's changed. It ain't like it was, right?
And the issue is you've changed. Because we just want to talk about what we've always talked about. And we want to, hey, listen, are we going to have to talk about issues and talk about specifics and things like that? We better. If we don't hear, where are we going to do it? As men, we can't be men and be challenged to think new ways about things and to be ironed as sharp as iron. If we can't do it and if we won't do it, where's it going to happen? You know, like the issue is like we're not, as I've said before, but we see that it's so important. We can't just meet on Fridays and come and be polite to one another and feel good because we got white people and black people in the room. Yeah, we can't just do that. Or we've got conservative leaning and liberal leaning people. We can't do that. That's not why Jesus died on the cross, so we can act polite for one another. He said he wants us to love one another. Right? So let's be intentional about the challenge of the truth. Let's be intentional about that. And that's what you hope you can count on. You can count on that among Christian men. Squeeze out all of the emotion that goes along with things and let's hear what the truth of the Word of God says. Let's bring ourselves in line with the truth that makes us free. Right? So like I was saying, our church on Sunday, you know, Will Rogers, I remember Will Rogers from a generation ago, Will Rogers says that ignorance is not so much a matter of what people do not know, as much as it is a matter of what people do know that ain't so. Now that'll make you ignorant with a capital E, right? All the stuff I know many times is what makes me ignorant. Because it ain't so. I know it. It just ain't so. I mean, I know it. I've been taught it. All my friends believe it. It's where I come from. It's where I think. We've always thought that this. Mama and them used to say, right? Right? We get all this stuff. Like I said, a compendium of stuff kind of floating around in our minds that we think is so. But it just ain't. And what happens is when we have these things, now this is not philosophy, is just true. It's the way truth works. It's the way when I know this and I embrace this, then it's difficult to get your fingers right. Unpride from around this stuff that I hold so closely. That's why the Bible says again, Proverbs 23:23. Buy the truth. It means it costs you. You got to give up something to get the truth. Buy the truth and don't sell it. So a lot of lies have to be dislodged. You got to be willing to give up lies in order to get the truth. And the truth of the matter is, a lot of people, and many times in my life, are not willing to do it. Because it's so stinking inconvenient. And it's so expensive. It's going to cost me things I believed all my life. It's going to challenge me in areas I'm not sure I want to be challenged in. So again, it's easier to just group up with people who think like me and say, yeah, look at them over there. You know what I'm talking about. People do it. Men do it about women. Women do it about men. Black people do it about white people. White people do it about black people. Conservatives do it. See, what we do is we throw labels out there, and then that says to everybody in my group, that signals what to believe about them. You know what I'm saying? So we won't delve down into what truth is many times and what God is saying to us and how to live in the world like we are. Hey, guys, let me show you this verse. By the way, we won't be going to 7:30 in these meetings. We don't have to prepare food and all of that. So we'll be going to about 7:15, all right? We'll try to give you enough if Tim don't take up so much time. So, no, I'm just kidding. But we'll try to go to about 7:15. Guys, and then I don't know how, let me ask you this question. Jason, how is that list looking for next week? Okay, 16 people. So here's what I've said. If nobody signs up, like if you want to be back next week, keep looking at that list, right? They can see the list. And say you get to Thursday and folks haven't signed up, sign up. We're trying to tell people sign up. That, in other words, that list should be filled already, right, with people who couldn't make it this week. They sign up for next week, right? If they're jiving, you know what I'm talking about, you get to Wednesday, Thursday, and you find out they're jiving, they ain't signing up, put your name on there, okay? Come back next week. But give others room. Now, Jason's about to come try to correct me about something. What? I don't know what you're saying. Tuesday. You're saying Tuesday. Oh, you did say Tuesday. I thought we talked about, I thought I said Thursday, but. Yeah, right. Okay, all right. Yeah, all right. Okay, all right. So that's already advertised, all right? All right, so I was trying to give more grace than Jason did, all right? But, So anyway, but that's good. This is how we just got to fill it out, figure out how to go forward, okay? Turn to Proverbs 17, just one verse here. Proverbs chapter number 17. I just want to give you this word, okay? My time is already gone, but Proverbs 17:1. And here's a great verse to memorize, if not memorize it verbatim, memorize this principle, this truth. See if you agree with this. I mean, really agree. Not just know what I believe, but do I believe what I know? All right? Not just saying, okay, yeah, I know that verse. I've read that verse 1,000 times. Better is a dry morsel, a crust of bread, better is a dry morsel and quietness therewith. Quietness has to do with tranquility and peace. And you know, peace is not so much an absence of trouble around you as much as it is a quietness and an absence of trouble within you. Right? If you're looking for peace to be an absence of trouble around you, you will never have it in the world. You'll never have it in your life. Peace is the absence of trouble on the inside. Doesn't mean you're impervious. It doesn't mean that you are somehow, your Christianity has made you immune to humanity, like you're not touched by things in the world. But there is a superlative peace that comes from God, a peace that passes an understanding. And he says here, better is a dry morsel and quietness therewith than a house full of sacrifices with strife. Do you believe that? Okay? Because if I fundamentally believe that, then that changes my pursuit in life. My pursuits are different. I won't be so busy going after stuff and abundance and forfeit peace and quietness of soul and quietness of and tranquility of relationships and my family and in my home. I won't give up that in pursuit of, you know, what's in the garage and what's in the refrigerator and what's in the freezer and what's in the cupboard and what's in the short storage shed and what's in the bank account. I won't give up quietness and tranquility of soul and family, well-being of my household for those things. This goes back to something we've talked about many times. Here is the, there is a, what we've called a foolishness in fullness. You know, having a house full of sacrifice, having a freezer full of food. Now, he's saying a dry morsel, just a piece of rye bread, you know, is better than having all kinds of animals that's been sacrificed and having a full banquet. It's better to have just a dry morsel and have measure of quietness, tranquility, and peace, right? You follow all through the Bible, that thought goes through the Bible. And by the way, guys, let's learn to love and to want what's better, right? This is a part of maturity. You know, like, we know what's right, we know what's wrong. At least we ought to. This is right, this is wrong. But maturity happens when we begin to learn what's good, what's right, what's wrong, what's good, what's what? Better, what's best. Right? You have that discernment. I was talking about this a couple of Tuesday nights ago when we met. You have this discernment. I'm going to choose this over that. Not that this is wrong, but this is better. Right? This is better than that. That's one of the things that happens when you begin to have discernment. You begin to know what's better than that. And he says it's better to have a dry morsel than filet mignon if I've got to forfeit quietness and tranquility. And this principle runs through the Bible, because here's the thing. There is what you might call the foolishness of fullness. You follow me in through the Bible. Think about yourself. Me and you know in your own life. Seems like the more we have, like the more foolish we become. You know what I'm talking about? The more we have, the more foolish we become. That's just a, you find that principle. The Bible says in Psalm 37:16, a little that a righteous man has is better than the riches of many wicked. The little that I have and I'm right with God, that's Psalm 37:16. The little that I have and my heart is right with God and I have an accompanying peace and quietness and tranquility that comes from being right with God and right with myself and right with others. That's better than the riches of many wicked. Fools who are full of this and that and the other thing. How we all need to learn how to choose what's best. Again, that verse over in 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, is it verses 22 and 23? Maybe y'all can look at it, but it says this. It says, test everything. Prove everything. The King James says, prove all things. It means test, right? part of maturity, where I learn how to discern and test everything. Right? It's Ephesians 5:10, in all things I want to be pleasing to the Lord. I'm to discern what's pleasing to the Lord. That's the criterion that everything must meet. Does it please the Lord, right? So this Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:22 and 23, prove all things, test all things, test everything. Don't just be an airhead with your ears open and your mind wide open and just, you know, everything comes in and I accept it. Grown men can't do that. Okay, maybe little children are open and gullible and naive and they do that. They have to even learn. I remember a friend of mine, my brother's friend, he was like 5 years older than me. His name was Tom. He was a wise aleck. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, a smart aleck. You know, one of those guys. But he played practical jokes on everybody. And I remember I was 4 years younger than him, and I must have been 4 or 5 years old. He talked me into giving him my dime because he had a nickel and it was bigger. And I gave it up. You follow what I'm saying? But that's a little boy. And beg your pardon? I ain't changed much. Okay, so that's exactly what the world will do. We'll find ourselves giving up that which is of greater value for something of far less value. So we have to be discerning. We can't be like little children. And so we have to test all things, prove all things. Then the Bible says, hold fast that which is good. I'm going to tell you right now, you don't want to be guilty of rejecting what God receives. Now, you don't want to be guilty of receiving what God rejects either. That's why you have to be discerning. You have to be testing everything. Does this please the Lord? Because I don't want to reject anybody the Lord received, but I don't want to receive that joker if the Lord rejects him. I just want to be on the Lord's side. I want to do what's right before the Lord. I don't want to receive something that God wants me to know, that God wants me to receive, but I don't want to reject. I mean, I don't want to reject what God wants me to receive and receive what God wants me to reject. I've got to learn how to be discerning and to prove all things, test everything by the straight line and that straight edge of God's word. Put it up against my life and it'll show me where I'm warped. Put it up against this principle and or this thing that you're hearing and you'll see where it's wrong. We do that with everything. Then hold fast that which is good. But then it says what? Abstain. Stay away. Reject all what? Appearance of evil. After I've tested it, take the good and reject the bad. But it takes discernment to know what's right, what's wrong, what's good, what's better, what's best. God's going to hold you responsible for that. Me too. It's a part of growing up. So we won't be talking about this when we come back, all right? Better things, better things, better things, all right? So let's look to the Lord in prayer. Before Richard come, guys, let me just say this. The Band of Brothers we've survived through this hard, this time. We were paying for breakfast and all that by what you put on the table, but over this period of time, we've paid Jason. Jason has been working. He hadn't been having to come and set up all this stuff, but he's been keeping us online and keeping us in touch. And so we've tried to pay Jason. The girl who does all of our video clips, we've been paying her. It was right for us to do that. And so I'll just say to you, if you've got anything to put on the table, you know we're not charging you to come. This is not what that is. If you have anything to help us to kind of like get back to where we need to be, that'll be a blessing. Okay, Richard, you want to close us in prayer when you come, or you want to say, all right, thank you. All right, Richard Barrow, all right, get that thing down. All right.
I've missed all you guys. Everyone, I don't know you personally, but I do know you as a Band of Brothers, and I can tell you people all over town have come up to me and and said, "Hey, when we start the band of brothers back, when?" So this is special, guys. People heard about it, and whether you think you're making a difference or not, you are making a difference in each other's lives, if nothing else.
So. So the other day, Jimmy Gumby, for years, he came here, I don't know, he's 75 years old when he came. He's a retired man, driver for overnight for years. But he made the grits, you know. And Jimmy died here not long ago. He's with the Lord. Y'all know Jimmy right here in this area. And but I was at the funeral. Went to the funeral, and his wife stood up, and she went on and on about the band of brothers and the difference it made in that man's life. Went on and on. Anybody was there? Anybody else? But she went on and on talking about that. But this is not the only wife that I've heard. Steve Hartley, he's with the Lord. His wife has said to me the difference she saw in his life. And I trust people can say the same thing about me and about you, that there's a difference when men get together and iron sharpens iron. So we collectively, by the way, she didn't say, "Kenny Grant, you made a difference." She said, "I can't tell you what the band of brothers has done." See, there's a dynamic here. Nobody better try to take credit for that. Not Richard, not me, not Jason, not any of us individually. God has done it, but he's done it through just men being together. So it's going to get better. It's going to get better, but I just want to let you know that.
You finished? Hey, guys. All right, I'm getting like Doug Weathers now in the microphone and the camera. You better watch out. Don't get between me and the microphone. Hey, guys, but what I was going to tell you, this small crowd kind of reminds me of the days when we were back in the lodge, 30, 40 guys. We were in there just yucking it up. And look what God's done to us. Ministries across town and here. Couple hundred here, close to 200 here on Friday mornings normally, and 100 us out of town, and that just, we got over 1,100 guys on our email list that's been here or getting the emails and getting the videos, and guys, it's special, and I tell you, I missed all you guys, I really did. And Kenny, giving up a nickel for dime ain't bad as giving up a car for a bus, a Greyhound bus, I can tell you that. That's a bad story. But, guys, good to see all you guys back out. Please be careful. Stay healthy. And if you happen not to be coming after you've signed up, please let us know, because we got some empty seats here. And we had guys on the waiting list. So we buy food. And we just don't want to have an empty seat here because, people are trying to get in. So if there's any way that you know you're not coming with any time available, please let us know, and we'll have a waiting list that we can call and say, "Hey, you can show up." Tuesday morning, we got a few seats available, so if you want to go to Tuesday, please do. And I'll close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we could be here and see the band of brothers back in action, Lord. And when I say in action, we want to be bigger and better and the best, as Kenny mentioned this morning. We want to be the best, and the best in our lives, best with our families, and best as being a man. So, Lord, be with us. Be with our country. We are in some polar times where we're hearing all the noise. But let that noise not direct us, but you keep us in the direction you'd have us to go. Let us look to you for all things, Lord, that we see you. As we go through our lives, we see through you. Not beside us, not calling you when we're in trouble or in need, in front of us. Let us think of you before we do anything and have any actions out there, okay? Thank you, dear Lord. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen.